I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. Come my children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord. One is walking with us still, turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice when you cry.
Hey, well, good morning, everybody. Happy 4th of July. Yeah, it's a blessing to have the freedom that we have to worship together, to gather together, especially in the state of Florida. But, you know, there's still a lot of places where it's not accessible, and so we're blessed. I'm blessed that you're here and thankful that we can worship together. I'm going to go through announcements right now, but just so, as you're walking in, as you're getting settled, today we're going to be having a communion service. So we'll spend some time in the Word, reflect on some of the things that we have been talking about, on the grace of God upon the cross. You know, Jesus' instruction here is, remember me. So we want to do that. And so in just a little bit, a time for you to sit with Jesus, right? And not rushed or hurried, but instead really just a time for you to spend time and not overlooking the Word just because we're so familiar with it, but communion, right, to commune with Him. And so just a really vitally important time for us in the practice of our faith to give you opportunity to engage with Christ, right, to sit with Him, to hear from Him personally. And that's going to be the close of our service, and so I'll give you further instruction as we move along here, but I want to move to announcements as well. So if you have your bulletins, let's go ahead and open those up. It's kind of unique, 4th of July on a Sunday, doesn't happen often, and as we have, you know, 4th of July today, lots of activities, lots of people out and about doing special things today. Fireworks and so forth. Hopefully we won't have fireworks here today, but Lord willing, we just want to impress you with Christ. But as we have that, and you guys are going to be out and about, there's not going to be any meetings tonight. So the prayer time tonight will be next week. We meet regularly on Sunday nights for prayer, but tonight we'll take a break. You can pray and wherever you're at, but the prayer meeting will be taking a break this week for 4th of July. So along with that, the young adults. You can see the young adults are taking a break as well. So both of those meetings won't be happening tonight. Now, in your bulletin, as you're looking down the list, what's happening at Calvary? You know, after I told you what's not happening, now what's happening at Calvary? Pre-registration for VBS, as we're heading towards VBS really quickly here. It's an opportunity to register your child, to get the kids in your life, neighbors, relatives, grandkids, all that kind of stuff. To be inviting people, to let them know. The sign-up registration table is out front, right when you came in the front door. Other information on that table as well for the Vacation Bible School. Some of the things I want to mention to you, there's a flyer that looks like this on that front table. We're going to be changing the scenery here. We're going to be setting up, you know, making the scene for the Vacation Bible School. And there are some things you could be a part of to be, help for that. Next July 11th, next Sunday, we're going to be decorating the church. Some things to decorate. You can see kind of a beach theme, island theme. And on this list, there's some suggested items. Make sure you mark your name on there so you get it back. This is available up front so you can review it and look at it. So we're excited about that. So as you look at your bullets, you can see ways to be a part of the Vacation Bible School. Sign up at the front, on that front table, lots of information up there, lots of suggestions. And again, next Sunday after the service, we'll be setting up the building. So if you want to be helping with that, it would be a great blessing to the team. So next Sunday. Continuing down the list, you can see the first Wednesday lunch. Guys, we have a Wednesday lunch on the first Wednesday of the month. Every month we gather together in the lobby. You bring your own lunch for yourself, and then we'll share in fellowship. If you want to bring food to share, that's fine. But the plan is, you know, grab a sandwich, grab a burger, bring something from home, and we come together and we share in fellowship. It's a good time. If you can't make it this Wednesday, the first Wednesday of July, you can plan on just making that a practice in the coming months. Every first Wednesday, the guys gather for lunch. Next, you can see we have a summer series for the ladies, second Saturday summer series. And as you look at that, it's the second Saturday. That's this Saturday, the second Saturday of every summer month. And you can see the details for this. Now, ladies, I hate to disappoint you, but this is not a food opportunity. There's not a breakfast with us. There's not any obligation to bring anything. So come with your bellies full and be ready to share in fellowship. It's a blessing. You know, we jokingly call ourselves Calorie Chapel. I was up at Crystal River Calvary Chapel recently, and you know, when you go into town and you look to see what restaurants are the best, I went to Crystal River and I looked to see what, and Calvary Chapel was in the top 10. I was surprised to see that. But there's not always food. I'm just trying, that's the point I'm making. So it's this ladies' second Saturday. It's been a real blessing. Excited to see what the Lord's doing in the fellowship with the ladies. So that's coming up this coming Saturday. It's 9 to 11 here at the church. Invite others, encourage others. You can see all the details for list on the list here. Childcare is available, so make sure you sign up for that. It's been a real blessing. Next, you can see the young adults are having a taco night Saturday, July 11th at 5 p.m. at the Floors. If you have any questions, if you want to be a part of that, you can see the information listed there and check their Instagram and all that kind of stuff. Talk to Ben and others, and you can be a part of that. Marriage Fellowship coming up July 18th, and as you look at this, you can see it's at the Negris. I'm sorry, it's 16th. You can see it's at the Negris house coming up this 16th, and it's at 6:30. Sign up for this, available up in the lobby on the sign-up table. Next, you can see the men's breakfast. After Vacation Bible School, opportunity to kind of clean up and reset. So guys, come on out. We'll cater the breakfast and feed you, because you're going to be working. It's a blessed time. The more guys we have show up, the easier the work. So guys, if you could come on out and help, it would be a real blessing to reset the sanctuary and the lobby and clean up after the festivities of Vacation Bible School. So that's coming up Saturday, July 17th. There's a sign-up sheet for that as well, flyer and so forth, and we just encourage you to be a part of that. Family Park Day, been enjoying these. Even in the heat of the summer, we got a shelter. It helps out. Shelter number 2 at Wall Springs Park, July 25th. You can check the details for that. Haven is the contact. Her email is listed there. Men's Conference, our prison ministry, every once in a while, month has a fifth Saturday. And those fifth Saturdays, what they come like, what, four times a year. And it's an open schedule slot for the prison ministries. And so we get to do something special on that day. So, guys, if you're already pre-registered, if you've been screened to go to prison, make sure you're a part of this. You got to be pre-screened. You can't just walk in. And it's too late. Now, if you want to be a part of the prison ministry, you have to have a background check and all those kind of things, pre-screen, all that kind of stuff. So if you haven't been through that process and you want to be a part of the prison ministry, you got to sign up for that. So make sure you're doing that. But if you've already been, we've had a long time period where we haven't been able to get into Zephyr Hills Correctional because of the COVID protocols and so forth. So we're excited to get back in. A lot of you guys have been involved in the past, and you haven't been able to get in, and maybe you kind of lost the motivation. Well, let's come back to that, remotivate. Let's make sure that we have a zeal to be a part of this. The guys at the prison have been a great blessing to us. Great church in there, great guys. And they are really blessed by your presence. And this conference is gonna be really important. So I encourage you to be considering that. Guys, if you've already signed up to be a part of the prison team, Make sure you're a part of this Saturday coming up, July 31st, the fifth Saturday of the month. Jose's heading this up. His email's listed there. Next, you can see the cafe, blessed with the breakfast this morning. Thanks to the team that did that. We should clap for food, for servants. But, you know, every week they're a blessing to us. Having the coffee and different things available for us just helps us in fellowship. We need to support that group and be filling the team. So as you look at this, if you would consider being a part, cleaning up, especially after the service, but any activity back there with the cafe, if you'd like to be a part of it, now's the time to reinforce that team. You can check the information there. The email listed is just the office information, but ask around if you have any questions. Next, you can see the Calvary Distinctives class. That's coming up. We have a beginning date there, but we're actually going to be adjusting that because some of the schedules of the teachers. Just a class that we go through regularly. It'll be before the service. It's 9 a.m. on Sunday mornings. Again, the starting date will be announced, rearranged there in weeks to come. But it's just a way to express to you who we are as a church, where we come from, why we do what we do, and all those kind of things. So if you're new with us or if you're curious about that, you can be a part of that class. It's been a real blessing to many. Well, as you close your bulletin, if I thoroughly confused you, make sure you reread it and ask questions. Make it a practice to revisit the table, talk, ask, invite others. Make it a practice after the service to do those things, and make sure you're being a part of all that's going on. As you close your bulletin, some things to mention. As we have given you not only opportunities to connect and be engaged, we gave you some opportunities to pray. Be praying for the Vacation Bible School, not starting this week, but the following. Pray for safety and for blessing, for lots of kids to be able to be here, for the team, for the fellowship, for the work of the Holy Spirit. I know in my life, Vacation Bible School imprinted on me. You know, there's things that I remember about Vacation Bible School as a young child that are still important to me. So just a real important time for us to be praying for that. So pray for Vacation Bible School. Pray for the prison ministry. Lots of things going on with that. I haven't updated you recently, but just to let you know, U-Turn up at Crystal River, a recovery ministry, helping those men that are struggling with different addictions to see those chains broken by the grace of Christ. That ministry has started. Our overseer, Johnny, has arrived, and our first resident has arrived. So pray for that. Pray for those initial steps. It's a blessing. Lots of opposition and obstacles, but God worked it out. And so we're excited about that. And we'll try to keep you up to date on that. And just keep them in prayer. Just add that to your prayer list, the U-Turn ministry. Along with that, last week, Haven updated us on the ministry with Hope Alive. And in Eswatini, they changed their name. It was Swaziland, now it's Eswatini. There is some inner turmoil there. There's some struggles there in the nation. There's a lot of upheaval right now. There's a lot of concern. They've informed Rick and Linda, our missionaries there, basically to lock down, to be prepared. There's a lot of concern there. So what some of those things, just with the ongoing struggles with the monarch there, they have a monarchy. But as well, some of the lockdowns and the COVID, the fallout from COVID, there's just a lot of political pressure. There's a lot of tension and turmoil building up there. So let's pray for Swaziland. Let's pray for Eswatini. Let's pray for Hope Live, for our missionaries, Rick and Linda, as well, that they just are protected. They have discernment, and God's grace guides them. Also, I want to pray for Gary Maddox. Gary, a lot of you have been praying for him. Gary has recently gone into the hospital for a bone marrow transplant. And the chemo that they give you for that, it's a major battle. And just want to be praying for him today, especially as he's just kind of begun that process of really entering into the struggle of it. It's a real struggle. So hold Gary in prayer and encourage you to continue to do that. We'll do that in a moment. And let me encourage you as well. As a church, the fervent prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. It matters. It makes a difference, right? So pray about these things. Keep your bulletin handy. Add those things to your prayer list. Be a part of the prayer chain. If you're not part of the prayer chain, let us know. We'll add you to the list. We email out requests, or if you have needs, send them to us, and we send them out to the team. Lots of people praying. And be a person that prays. When somebody comes to you and says, hey, you're dealing with this, struggling with this, don't say, I'll pray for you. Pray for them right there, right? And then say, I'll pray for you, right? Make sure you're praying with each other. Pause in the middle of conversations and let's just say, hey, let's pray about that. And just hold each other up in those things. So let's pray right now for some of these things that I just mentioned. Lord, we come before you, Lord, thankful. Lord, very aware of this great privilege of prayer. Lord, reminded even now the fervent prayer of the righteous is effective, it's powerful. Lord, that's because of you, because you hear our cries. And Lord, we do cry out to you. In this room today, Lord, there are a lot of different things that people are struggling with. Lots of personal battles, a lot of things in their lives that are concerning or strike fear or anxiety. Lord, lots of things that we see happening in our culture, Lord, that just weigh on us. Lord, we bring you our needs. Lord, we lay our lives before you. Lord, we ask for your presence. Lord, hear our cries, hear our prayers. Lord, these things that I've just mentioned, Lord, lifting up Gary in his needs right now. Lord, lifting up Eswatini, Rick and Linda, the ministry there, the need there. Lord, lifting up the Vacation Bible School and all, Lord, that you desire to do during that time, the prison ministry. Lord, all these different ministries that we've mentioned. Lord, the opportunities at U-Turn. Lord, there's just so many things that we want to lift up to you, Lord, because you're the shepherd of our soul. Lord, because you care for us. And Lord, we cast our cares upon you. Lord, we turn to you. We humble ourselves right now, and we admit, Lord, just humble, surrendered, Lord, contrite. Lord, we humbly admit right now, Lord, that we need you. Lord, that what's needed in this room is not another sermon. It's not another church service. Lord, what's needed in this room is Jesus. We need you desperately. Lord, we just lay our lives before you. Lord, we bring you our hearts. Lord, in a time of communion, Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would meet with each individual person, that you would truly make this a time of communion. Lord, that you would respond to the needs of our heart, the weakness, the brokenness of our heart, that you'd pour out your grace and your mercy. Lord, that this time would be powerful and effective. Lord, that you would be glorified. That all glory and honor, all attention, all focus would be given to you. Lord, may we step out of the way and just yield to you and give you room to move and work. Lord, we invite you to do that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's tuck our bulletins away and again encourage you to revisit that, add those things to your prayer list. Make note of those things and just really, really invite you to pray, implore you to pray over those things, need you to do that. Well, as we approach communion, let me step away from this for a moment. Let me give you some practical instruction. As we practice communion regularly on Wednesday nights, some of you on Sundays, you don't haven't had a communion service, experienced a communion service with us. So I'm going to give you some instructions so you're not lost in the mix. First of all, these are our elements, and with COVID and the concerns of that and so forth, we've gone to these prepackaged elements. And so a little different. Some of you look at them curiously. They're not a novelty. They're not a souvenir. Well, they could be a souvenir. You could take this home and treasure it. But as you look at it, there's two sealed, both ends are sealed. The one end has the bread, the little wafer, the little cracker. It's delicious. We tried to get ranch. They were all sold out. But anyways, all of these are gluten-free. So anybody with gluten issues, you don't have to worry about it. They're all gluten-free. You want to open up the bread portion first. It's the easier thing to do. Do the bread first. And then on the other side is the juice, and you want to open it up that carefully. As we do this, Now, we do this differently. We're not necessarily, anchored into one way or the other. We're doing this congregationally in the sense that we're all together. Today, we're going to do it where you go to the table personally when you're ready. When the Holy Spirit leads you, when you're directed, when you feel your heart is ripe before the Lord, you can go and receive the elements. Go ahead and take one of these and return to your seat. And pray over it, right? And remember the instruction, remember me. You want to think upon Christ and what he did for us, that he made a way for us even this morning to be here. And then you receive the elements personally yourself, recognizing the broken body of Christ, the bread. And then secondarily, you go to the juice, which represents the blood of Christ shed for you. And you want to thank him for that, pray over that, and take that in and commune with him. So in a little while, when we return to worship, it'll be an opportunity for you to sit with the Lord, to spend time with the Lord. And when you've brought your heart to him, it is a time of confession. If there's sin in your life, repent. Turn away from yourself. Turn away from selfishness. Turn away from sin and turn to Jesus, right? When you've done that, when your heart is right, when you felt like you've spent time with him, then you want to take in, you want to commune with him by taking the elements, right? We invite you all to do that and encourage you to do that. We'll have the time of worship, and during the time of worship, as you're led, you can go and take of the elements. Now, as I say that, you can see that we have three stations in this room. There's these two trays right here in front of me, and then in the back corners, there are the high-top tables. There's a tray over there, and there's baskets over there. You can go to those, whichever you feel comfortable with or is easily accessible. Just encourage you to spend time with him. If you're here with your family, your wife, I would encourage you to share together as a couple, right? Husbands, pray for your wives, right? Talk with her about this. Wives, if your husband's not comfortable doing that, be gracious. Don't worry about it. But if you're able, guys, we encourage you to do that. There are people that have a phobia almost of praying out loud, or maybe you're not used to it. And we understand that, so there's grace. We're not going to force you to some place where you're super uncomfortable with it, only if you're comfortable. But I will say as well, listen, guys, or anybody here that's uncomfortable with public prayer, we'll be patient, we'll be gracious, but get over it. You need to get over it, right? We'll be gentle, we'll be patient, but we're going to work you toward that place where you will pray out loud. You're missing out if you haven't been doing that. All right, so that's the general thing, the general instructions. So we'll go back to worship in a moment. We'll give you time to commune with the Lord. During that time of worship, you can sing with us, you can stand, you can sit, you can pray together. You can get up and move. If there's somebody you feel led to pray with or for, you can go and pray with them. It's a time where we want to spend with the Lord, right? And as you're doing that, bringing your heart to the Lord, fresh surrender, fresh worship and appreciation. As your heart's right with the Lord, confess and bring those things to him that need to be forgiven, or areas of your life where you're broken or hurting. Just bring those things to him. Let his grace and mercy, infinite grace and mercy, let it be poured out into your life. And when you're ready, you can come here to this table up front or one of the tables in the back. You can sit back down with your elements. And when you're ready, you can share the elements. If you're with your family, you can share together. If you want to do that privately, you can do that privately. But sharing the elements. If we get all the way to the end of the service and you haven't had an opportunity to get one of the elements, at the end of the service, you can do that still, right? Sometimes some of the people that are serving will come in after we're done, because they've been with the kids or they've been out in the cafe cleaning up or something like that. They'll come in after the service. Sometimes the worship team didn't have a chance. They'll come in after and they'll share in communion. You can do that as well. So that's the practical instruction. Let's go ahead and turn to the Word and just refresh ourselves in some things. I have a couple anchor passages that I'll ask you to turn to. I'll mention some others. You don't have to turn to all of them. You can if you're comfortable. But let's, for just this point of all of us being in, having a scripture in front of us, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Now, make sure you're not in 1 Corinthians like I just was. That verse looked very foreign to me. That wasn't the one I wanted. 2 Corinthians, not 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Now, as you go here, the focus of this passage or this verse is liberty. Fitting for today, right? Liberty, the 4th of July. As we have a day where we celebrate and are thankful for the freedom of this country and the liberty that we have in this country, I think it's good for us to have communion and realize and recognize the root of our freedom, of our liberty, and to experience it to the full. As you turn to 2 Corinthians verse 17, Paul writing to the church in Corinth, "Now the Lord is the Spirit," right, the Holy Spirit, "and where the Holy Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." Now, as we read this verse, just some basic things here, first and foremost. I appreciate our founding documents in this country, in our nation. One of the primary reasons I appreciate them is they recognize that freedom is from the Lord, right? That we have unalienable rights, right? You don't, the Constitution, the founding documents, they don't grant us our rights. We have our rights because they're God-given. I'm thankful for that. And I want to remind you of this. It's not the Constitution that set you free, right? It's not some thoughts of a founding group of men or documents or the workings of our governments. Your freedom is locked up in this truth, Jesus Christ. That's where your freedom is. And to recognize this, listen, we live in a day and age, and I think it tends to happen. Generationally, we see this, where there's this gap between generations, and there's these kids today kind of attitude. You know, there's always that tension where we feel like there's people around us that don't really appreciate the freedom that we have. Well, and I think that, you know, growing up in the midst of this, you can tend to take it for granted. You can tend to forget or not recognize or not appreciate what we truly have, right? There is that sense. But I can tell you this, that being granted the blessing of being able to travel to a lot of different places around the world on mission trips, being able to share the love of Christ with the church and with people around the world. I've been in a lot of different places, a lot of places that are oppressed, places that are oppressed with their system of government, or places that are oppressed with the religiosity, right, the ritualistic religion of the culture, or places that are oppressed with poverty. I've been to a lot of places. I've been to places where, you know, I've stayed with families, been in homes where people have dirt floors and a wood fire oven, you know, and their home is built out of scraps from the junkyard. I've been to places of oppression. And what has shocked me, honestly, to my core again and again, is that I meet people that have way less than I do, are suffering way more than I have ever imagined, and yet they have a joy and an expression on their face that I see something in them of happiness, of freedom from fear and anxiety. There's this lack of burden. There's this freedom in their heart and their thankfulness to the Lord. They have something I don't, right? And I've looked at them and experienced, and again, in a lot of different places I've experienced this, not just one soul moment, but a lot of different places. And I've recognized this as a believer. There are people outside of the borders of this country. There are people that are underneath the Constitution and the freedom that we have naturally in those documents. They don't have any of that. They have, in fact, a lot of other things that we would think are oppressive, and yet, because of Jesus, they're freer than I've ever been. In fact, I mentioned it earlier, but those of you guys that have been to Zephyr Hills Correctional, there are guys in Zephyr Hills Correctional, believers in Christ, that are there for a long time, many of them serving multiple life sentences. And you talk with them, and you recognize they're freer than a lot of people I know out here. What is that? Can I tell you something? That on this day that we focus and celebrate on freedom, can I tell you something? These issues have crept into the church, and there are a lot of people within the church. There are a lot of us here in this room today. There are a lot of churches around us today. That there are people coming in and out of the doors of a church, but they don't know the freedom that they have in Christ. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. It's because he's all about freedom, right? And in that sense, as you recognize that, when we look at this country and we see where we're headed and what's going on, a lot of us think, well, you know, politics. I don't know why we continue to do that. It's only been an obstacle, and it's not been a solution, rarely been a solution for us. Listen, we don't need political solution. The opposite of this verse is true as well. When we look at our nation, we wonder what's going on. You know what's going on. Do we need to get rudimentary? Do we need to go back to basics and remind you? What's lacking in this nation is the Spirit of the Lord. Can I get even personal and more specific with you? If in your life you feel frustration, you feel oppression, you feel burdened, you feel locked down, you feel limited, you know what's lacking in your life? You know what the real battle is? Listen, it's not all these things that you could point to on the surface level, on the practical level. It's not your boss. It's not your family. It's not your job. It's not where you've been. It's not what you've been through. No, what's lacking in your life is a work of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'll admit that this can be a progressive work. But our reliance needs to. There might be a way that there are things that God will lift from me in the days to come that I've carried for years. I'm willing to give room for that patient work of the Holy Spirit. But what I want to encourage you in is this. If you're carrying burden, your only solution and your only hope is a work of Jesus Christ. It's a work of his grace. It's a work of the Holy Spirit. Your reliance and your hope needs to be centered and locked in on that truth. There's no election that will solve it. There's no job that will solve it. There's no fix to your family that will solve it. There's no move in your income and your finances and your bank account and your health and your relationships. There's no move that will solve these problems absent of the work of the Holy Spirit. Centered in that, relying on that, dependent on that, the work of the Holy Spirit is. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And I'll tell you what, I think there's a greater freedom, there's a richer experience of this available to all of us. None of us have fully arrived or graduated to this. For all of us, there is an opportunity to recognize, oh, but for the work of the Holy Spirit, I can experience communion with him, a continued walk with him, continued faith in him will be a progressive work, a deepening, enriching, a growing, vibrant experience of freedom. Do you know what freedom is? I don't think you do. I'll humbly admit, I don't. When I look in the eyes of a pastor on one of the islands in the Caribbean, and I see him living in a humble shack, you know, dirt floors, and I see a smile and a joy and a hope in his heart and it gleaming out of his face, out of his eyes, when I see that, I recognize there is a freedom deeper than I know. And so I lay those things out, not to castigate, right? Not to wag a finger at you, not to accuse you, but instead to invite you, to stir up in you a hope and an expectation, to stir up in you an eagerness and a motivation. Lord, I want that. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Now, last couple weeks, the guys have shared. Thank you for Pastor Jim, Pastor Ben, Jose covering. Sometimes, yes, you can thank them. Sometimes I need a break. I need to rest. You know what? I shaved my beard a couple weeks ago, and I needed to give it time to grow back. So I took a couple weeks off. grew it back. Anyways, working on the top, but we'll deal with that later. You know, as they share their heart, it's a great blessing to be able to take a break and to give guys opportunity to share and give you an opportunity to hear their hearts and for you to be blessed by them. It's a good for us to take a break and spend time in communion. It's good for us to reflect on these things, to pause and really let these truths work and minister to us. And there's been a lot of things that have been shared over the last, through the book of Titus, lots of things shared. If you would, turn to Titus chapter 2. Remind yourself of some of the things the Lord has put on our hearts and in this book of Titus, and some of the things that guys have shared, maybe some of the things that you've gleaned from your own personal prayer time, your own personal quiet time, being in the Word. Can I encourage you to be in the Word, right? To feed on the Word, the truth of God, and not to make it a chore, but to make it a practice of fellowship and relationship, of communion. Be in the Word. Invite God to speak to your heart. Right, the Lord speaks to you that, and it's enriching, right? And you're missing out. This is one of the workings of freedom, is being in the Word and praying and seeking the face of the Lord and letting the Word of God transform your life. And maybe God's been speaking to you through Titus, or maybe some of the things that guys shared over the last couple of weeks. Maybe God has spoken to you in your own personal time or your prayer time. This is a time to really thank the Lord and to dwell on that, to let the Holy Spirit bring real depth and rooting, to plant those things deep into your heart. This is a time to reflect on that. And Titus, just reflecting on some of the things that God has spoken to us and has encouraged us with. In Titus, the core verse that I had gone to again and again in our study is in chapter 2, beginning at verse 11, and fitting with this idea of freedom, of liberty, of communion. Verse 11 of Titus chapter 2, we've centered on this in our study of Titus. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. The rescue has come, right? And especially with communion. Would you focus today on personally the work of Jesus Christ, how he made a way for you, where there was a gap. We had a sin problem. We were desperately in need of help. Our sin had separated us and divided us from God. Our selfishness had pushed him away. There was a chasm, a canyon too broad for us to cross. We couldn't get back to him, and Jesus Christ made a way for the grace of God that brings salvation, right? And oh, what a day to stop and to celebrate this with communion. The day that you recognize this, the day that your eyes open to this, and maybe it's today, the day that you realize that Jesus Christ made a way to your heart, and that he found you in your need, and he came to you in that moment of brokenness, and he brought you rescue. For the grace of God, you didn't ask for it, this is a gift. You didn't earn it, you didn't deserve it, it's a gift. The grace of God that brings salvation, rescue to you. Jesus Christ has made a way to you. And that grace, continuing here in this verse 12, says, teaching us. God's grace teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. The other translations, one of the NIV says this, that God's grace teaches us to say to no, say no, say no to worldliness, right? To the lust of the world, to the things of the flesh, to say God's grace, not your determination, not your motivation, not your energy, but God's grace, his kindness, his mercy, his patience, his love, his grace teaches you, say no to selfishness. Say no to the worldly lust, desires of your life. Say no. God's grace teaches you that. Listen, be confronted with that today. Here we are at the communion table. Here we are thanking the Lord for his rescue. And understand there's not only that simple understanding of that rescue out of the pit of selfishness, out of our despair, out of our hopelessness, bridging that gap, bringing us back into his presence, into his love, through the rescue of Christ on the cross. That first moment, initiating moment of salvation, powerful, important. But that same grace teaches you to change, to grow up, to be different, no longer living for self and for sin and for me and my desires, but now living for Christ. Grace teaches you that. Are you teachable today? Are there things today that you need to recognize and learn? Are there things in your life that need to change? God's grace is teaching you, right, to be different, to live for him. The next verse, 13, says, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. This verse, again, the translation here, you know, that we are in this moment looking for, right? We're living day to day. We'll live our life to the full. We'll live our life in a sense of if the Lord gives me a full life and I live well beyond the gift of the typical average of years, praise the Lord. I'll live for him every day. But I also recognize this, that in that lifetime, there is going to be a generation. Somebody's going to be interrupted, right? They're going to have that moment of rapture. They're going to have a moment. There's going to be a generation. I do believe it could be ours. There's going to be that generation that doesn't have to live that full life waiting for that last breath. There's going to be a moment in the twinkling of an eye, in the snap of a finger. In that moment, his grace is going to call us home. In the church, all of us, the dead in Christ first, then all of us who are alive and remain, we're going to be caught up, called up, raptured up to him. In a moment, we're all going to be changed. Can't wait. Right? Can I tell you, that's the moment where you'll finally discover and know to the full what freedom is. No more burden of this selfish life, this broken body, this decaying world. No more of that. God will restore. He makes all things new, including you and me. Can't wait, right? This idea here, while we're waiting, right, while we're waiting for that moment. And some of the translations express it that way. While we're waiting, not just this idea of looking, but while we're waiting, we're going to live for him. And verse 14 confirms that, and it says, who gave himself, Jesus gave himself, that he might redeem us, you and me, rescue us, ransom us, purchase us out of the enslavement, the bondage that we were in, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify him for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. Now our lives are for him, right? Later on in the next chapter, it says, ready for good works. Are you ready? Right? What would the Lord have for you to do? How can we share his love? How can we be an expression of Christ? How can we share the gospel? How can we pray for people? How can we be a light in the dark world that we live in? While we're waiting, how can we live for him? He saved us for this. He has divine appointments for you. He has prepared in advance for you opportunity. Listen, if you have family and friends, there are people all around you already that need the love of Christ. Right, if you have a job and you're in the workplace, if you go to school, there are people all around you. The mission field is ripe. It's white unto harvest. The Lord is sending us out. He saved you to be zealous and to be ready, to be excited and eager. You get to do that. What a privilege it is to wake up every morning, even this week, to wake up and recognize, I get to be a blessing. I get to bring the love. I get to put a smile on his heart. I get to bring the love of Christ. I get to lift burdens. I get to point people to Jesus, right? The grace of God teaches us. God's grace, right now, right? Knocking on the door of your heart and saying, hey, life can be different.
There is a freedom available to you. There's an opportunity for you. There's an experience for you to know my love, to see your fears met with my peace, to have burden lifted, to bring rest to your soul. There's an opportunity for you to bring that to the world around you, to live differently while we're waiting to live for him. Now, last week, Pastor Ben shared with us the story of Matthew, the tax collector. And Matthew, the tax collector, was a man that was in bondage, right? And as Ben related this, you know, here's a guy that at some point, at some time, he rejects his culture, he rejects his family, whatever it was that motivated that, that moved him to that place. There's some upheaval moment. There's some turbulent moment in his life where he says, to his upbringing, to his family, to his relationships, to his friends, to his culture, he says, I'm done with you, and he goes and he serves the Romans. He's a tax collector. He betrays his people. He serves and works for, and not only serves and works for the Romans, but in such a way that he's a burden to the Jewish people, right? Zealously taxing for the enemy. Imagine the place that he's in. And as Ben shared, he begins to witness the ministry of Christ. He hears the stories. He sees people healed. He's watching from his tax collector booth. And there's a moment in Matthew's life where Jesus walks up to him right there. And if I don't know, there's in that moment, there's just this epitomized. It's a real true story, but it's almost this like symbolic, poetic picture, this imagery. If there is ever an epitomized image of a man trapped in bondage, wanting a way out, but there's no way out, looking, knowing, what did I do? How did, what, you know, all the shame and the guilt and the bondage, and there's no way. He may very well want out, but he can't get out. Right? And right in that moment, you recognize in that story, again, real life, you'll get to meet Matthew one day. You'll hear it expressed from his heart. But in that moment, you not only are witnessing this man in that place, trapped, lacking any notion of freedom, but in that moment, you could stop and go, that's me. Right? At some point, in some way in your life, that's you. And there's no way. There's no way out. And Jesus comes to Matthew. And I can, you know, you visualize this. And I can almost see the crowd, clamor of the crowd, the noise of the crowd following Jesus, right? Miraculous things have just happened. Energy, electricity, you know, noise. And Jesus is walking, and Matthew's watching this, and he sees him kind of coming in his direction. And Matthew's probably seeing, he's making eye contact with me. And, you know, that moment of nervousness and anxiousness. And Jesus is approaching step by step. He's closer, and he reaches out to Matthew. And what would he say to this man that's betrayed his people? What would he say to this man that is trapped in his sin and his selfishness? What would he say to this man that has failed royally? What would he say? And Jesus reaches out his hand and says, follow me. See, that moment and that scene, real, true life scene, is also imagery pointing to you to that same moment in your life. Right? Where you recognize that. Where you're in that place, hopeless and desperate, and there's no way out. And Jesus comes to you, and with a rescuing hand of grace, he brings salvation to you. And what he says to us this morning, you follow me. See, this morning, that's what we celebrate. When we talk about freedom, that's what we celebrate. What is it in the moment, right, in your life, your story, and that experience? Has that moment arrived in your life? Have you experienced that moment? Do you know that moment? Listen, if you haven't, maybe it's right now. Maybe even right now. Maybe you've been to church for a long time, but you've never been set free. Maybe it's right now. If that has been a moment that you can look back on, then recognize that communion today, right now, this is a day we celebrate. Do you know, back in Paul's day, when he writes to the Corinthian church talking about communion, you know, he calls it the love feast. The love feast. Now, my big belly, I always think, well, food, right? Food. Oh, they must have a lot of food. No. It's not they did have food, but that's not the point. No, they feasted on love. Wow. Do you know this morning? Listen, either it's this moment right now, or you're looking back on that moment and you recognize this, where you celebrate this, where you have this memorialized in your life, and you know that moment, and you come to this communion table, and you express, and you feast on, and you know this, that you are loved by Christ, that he's brought you a rescue, that there is hope, that you can know a freedom deeper and richer, more joyful than you ever imagined. Burden can be lifted, chains can be broken, anxiousness, fear, can be chased away because the perfect love of God has been poured out, inundated, overwhelmingly over us. You are loved. There is hope in this room. And recognize this, believer, if you're in that place where this is not a big deal, oh, it should be. Let me rephrase that. Oh, it can be. If I can go around the world and see people oppressed, and I see in their expression of the believer a freedom that I don't know, something should stir in my heart. It should stir in your heart. You recognize when I complain about those people out there that don't appreciate this country, and you don't like the flag, well, get out of here. You know what I'm saying? If I can feel that way towards them, isn't there a room for us in the church to say, you know what? If you don't appreciate this free, do you not know what you've got? Do you not know what is the privilege this is? Have you not been placed in a place where you're stirred by this? What was it in Matthew in that moment that caused him to leap up from the tax collector booth and every chain that was so heavy in bondage and the weight of it and the overwhelming thought of it, the oppression of it, it consumed his mind, the thought of what he'd been through and where he was and how he couldn't get out. But in that moment, when Jesus said, follow me, he sprang up and he walked away. What? Is that in us? Is that in you? Is there something in you? Could you be stirred with the potential of God's grace? Is there not a place? I don't care what chains are on you. I don't care what bondage you face. I don't care what you've been through and what the world's done to you or what your foolish choices have brought in your life. Do you recognize this? There's power in the blood of Christ. He sets us free. You're free today. Oh, I want Matthew's heart, right? That Matthew could spring up in that moment. Titus, he tells us, this grace that brought you salvation, are you ready for good works? Matthew was. Matthew in that moment stood up and walked away from everything that trapped him. He lived completely different from that point on. His life was transformed. Believers, today, there's freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. Well, bringing that moment back to that personal place of reflection, right? Recognizing there's freedom where the Spirit, the Holy Spirit's here now. And no one is looking with a condemning eye at anyone here. This is a hospital. We all come to this place and we recognize there are things that have ensnared us. There's bondage. There's things that we have faced. There's things that we all recognize that. Nobody here is wagging a finger of condemnation at you. We all recognize that we struggle. This is a hospital. We're here to get better. This morning, as we go back to worship, as we come to the communion table, believers, I mean, something was happening in Matthew. Matthew was watching Jesus work. He was seeing people set free. He was seeing the miraculous. He was hearing the teachings of Jesus, sitting there in his booth. Something was stirring in his heart. And when Jesus said the word, he sprang up from the trap of his sin and he walked away. Today, is that rumbling in your heart? Is there an expectation, right? Is there an anticipation? Somewhere in the heart of the believer, we need to respond. Matthew got up and he left his tax collector booth. Some of you today need to get up and walk away from the things that have ensnared you. And you need to celebrate the freedom that Christ won for you on the cross. Well, I'm going to invite the worship team to come up. They're going to lead us in worship. We're going to worship to the bottom of the hour. Opportunity for you to just, you know, whatever the Lord's been stirring on your heart. You know, I've brought up some things that have been on my heart, some things with our celebration of the 4th of July, some things that we've been studying and reflecting on in the past weeks. Maybe some of those things would remain on your heart. You want to deal with those things with the Lord personally. You want to pray and talk to the Lord, talk to the Holy Spirit, invite him to set you free, invite that work. Maybe something you've been reading in your quiet time. All of us, let's reflect on what Christ did to pay the price, right? Let's reflect on the cross. If there's sin in your life, repent. And repent really, truly means, hey, come home. Hey, come home. Turn away from sin and selfishness and turn to Jesus. Confess your sin. Let nothing be an obstacle to his grace this morning. Open your heart, ask him to search your heart, let him wash you clean. When you're ready, you can come to the table. There's this table up here, and there's the tables in the back. Take the elements, return to your seat, and just reflect on those things. The body of Christ, the blood of Christ shed for you. Let's commune with him. I'm going to pray, and then we'll continue in worship. Lord, we thank you for these moments. Lord, we thank you for the truth and the reality that your grace brings salvation to us. Lord, each one of us can celebrate, maybe even it's right now, that moment that you came to our tax collector booth and you reached your hand out to us. Lord, that you rescued us from our sin and selfishness, our brokenness. Lord, desperate, hopeless. Lord, you brought us grace and mercy, forgiveness. Lord, today we celebrate that. We put our faith in you. Lord, would you continue to bring freedom to us? Set people free today. Break chains, break bondage. Lord, no matter what the curse, no matter what's on us, your cross, your work, your grace, your mercy, more powerful, more authoritative, set people free. Bring the joy and the release of freedom to our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. And there's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the love that I've ever thank you. The great unchangeable I am.
you guys stand.
Let's have a seat, just some closing thoughts, and I want to pray a blessing over you this Independence Day. You know, as we celebrate communion, we celebrate the freedom that Christ won for us on the cross, and just encourage you to live in that freedom, right? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. If this week you feel oppressed, if you feel frustrated, if you feel discouraged, you know where your source of freedom resides. The reality is that your experience of freedom, right, that release of joy, that expression of liberty that Matthew felt, that so many felt when they met with Jesus, your experience of that freedom is directly correlated with your communion with Jesus. So if this week you lack that experience of freedom, then you know where to go. You go back to him. You cry out for a work of the Holy Spirit. Can I remind you of verses that we just alluded to in our singing? Jesus expressed this. He said this to the Jews who believed him. He said, If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Where does that start? Abide, right? Abide in his word. He later would say what we just sang, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. All right, so this celebration, this practice of communion is not to be cordoned off to this just experience at a church service. It is to be understood that this is a celebration of what Christ has made available to you 24/7. You have forever access to him, right? That's what we celebrate. Communion brings us back, resets our mind, resets us, realigns us to that truth. This week, commune with him, right? Well, let me pray a blessing upon you. Father, we come to you this morning thankful for the freedom of this country, but we acknowledge that our freedom is rooted and grounded in our relationship with you. Lord, would you train us and teach us by your grace to live for you and not for self. Lord, to seek you out, to abide, to dwell in, to live in you, in your word. Lord, would you open up your work through the Holy Spirit in your word, in our lives. Lord, in moments of frustration, in moments where we feel burdened, wearied, tired and worn out, in moments where we feel oppressed and locked in, Lord, remind us, call to us. Lord, beckon us back. Lord, teach us to turn to you. Lord, may this fellowship experience the ever-growing, vibrant work of the Holy Spirit, and may the release of joy, may the experience of freedom be richer and richer as your work progresses in our hearts. Lord, do that in us by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now go celebrate your freedom. Amen.